problem that you might have faced? Anything along those lines?
Just use of basketball as a term. The kids don't, at a young age, they're not used to it.
Yep. Yep. And they'll get different terms from different coaches.
That's right.
Yep. Yep. Your job, I think, as a coach is to try and clarify for them what those terms mean. That's always hard, because if you hear a new term, you go, oh, what's that? Yeah. It's like when I first came back to the Oakwood game, they were talking about pack defense. And I'm thinking, sag, not defense. It's still the same principles with a few variations in the thing. So I had to make the jump to the sexy terminology, as I call it. Because we used to have down screens and cross screens. Now you have drag screens and you have, what are they, up? No, the punch screens. Sorry, is it punch screens now? That's an up screen and all this sort of, it's all good language. It makes it, you know, seem a little bit more exciting than just that. But yeah, I think what we're going to try and do, there's a new guy started at Basketball Australia in sort of my role at the national level. And his name's Peter Lonigan. And one of the things he's targeting first is a standard terminology framework. So hopefully we'll have something that you can reference to. But what I'd suggest you do is maybe keep your own little notes. That's what I used to do. Because, you know, you go, when you're talking on-ball screens, there's drops and there's ice and there's hard show and flat show and all that sort of stuff. And there's about three different names they can use for the same thing. In some areas, so I used to write down where I've heard the term and made my own little glossary up, so that when the kids asked, I could relate it to them. But yeah, it's a minefield, and unfortunately, I'd like to say that it's going to get better, but it's not. Because coaches are coaches, and they try to differentiate the game, and that's one way they can differentiate the game. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Did not think of an answer, but I'd suggest the book. It's probably the one.
Skill levels, like in
one
team?
Multiple skill levels.
Multiple, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, look, part of the coaching dilemma is always that multiple skill level stuff. What I tend to do is I modify the skills that I'm doing. So in today's game, there's two ways to coach. Okay. As a player, if you've played before, you've probably been coached by some good coaches, and there's probably some bad coaches. What you tend to do is take the good things out of the good coach and ignore the things out of the bad coach and try and stay away from them. In the past, we found that that meant that traditional coaching, and I'll come to what it means in a second, was currently running through the whole thing. And if you follow a traditional coaching method, coaching model with kids' standards is very hard. Okay. So if I talk about what a traditional coaching is. Toomsy, just top up here. Come on,
Toomsy. Oh, my God.
Huh?
You want to stand up?
Just stand up. Just top up here. We don't have a basketball, but say if we had a basketball, if we got a basketball. Sorry. Here we go. Over there, mate. So, this is traditional coaching, right? Okay, Toomsy. You're going to pass the ball, Mark. You're going to come up here. All right, two of you. We got to learn the chest pass, right? So, Toomsy, there's the ball there. We're going to get the ball to Mark, okay? But before you do that, I want to see you grip the ball, fingers out, nice and straight, good. Now, nice even balance, get yourself balanced. Good, good, excellent. Now, head up, all right. Now, as you go, I want you to step forward, and as you step forward, I want you to push those hands out so they go out like that. Yeah, yeah. Oh, 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 oh. Just hold on. Toomsy, did I say left foot? Did I say left foot? No, I want you to use the right foot, okay? And I want you to... Do it, yeah, not that. Yeah, yeah. Not too bad. Just going to bring back. That toe probably needs to be pointed a little bit straighter. I'm exaggerating things here a little bit. But this is traditional coaching, yeah? Okay, so away you go. Good. Mark. Let's see how you go. Look, when you catch that ball, we'll talk about that later, but you've really got to catch that ball properly. That was something really to work on. Let's see how you go with your coaching dispatch. Right. Okay, so let's see. Get your hands right. Come on. Fingers nice and spread. Good grip on that ball so no one can slap it out of your hands. Good. And now you're going to step forward. Your right foot, Mark. Come on. And good. Okay. So that's boring as hell. But you get them to learn the skill that you want. And we spend a lot of time on what we call the micros. Yeah? getting the hands down, thumbs down. We used to spend a lot of time on that. How many has been coached like that? Been coached like that? Yep, okay. That's traditional coaching. There is a place for it when you're dealing with fundamentals, but we are now trying to get away from that a little bit. Because what that traditional coaching, leave the ball here, Tim's going to probably need it in a second. Because you're going to come back up in a second. What traditional coaching tends to lend itself to is fundamentals and really good, you know, teaching kids to be really good with their fundamentals. Okay, so they're very precise. At the other end of the scale, as they get better and better, and they get into higher and higher grades, what you tend to see is the old style of offences, which we call now the continuity offences. Because as a coach, we like symmetry. So you flex. Who's running? Anybody seen flex offence? Am I talking gibberish?
What's a flex offence?
Okay, flex offence is a pattern.
Okay.
And you down screen and cross screen, and you end up in the same spot. If you keep following it,
yep.
You end up in the same spot. It's continuity, which means it continues to rotate. Okay? But that's another traditional way of coaching, you know, shuffles and all that sort of stuff. So coaches like training sessions that look good. You know, you're walking, geez, the drill looks good. Geez, they're firing, guys. Yeah, wow, these guys are perfect, you know. Layups, they're not letting the ball drop, they're picking it up. That's the sort of thing you get in traditional coaching. The problem with that is you don't get problem solvers.
No.
You tend to get robotic.
And the kids aren't like that this time.
Correct. So two factors. Our kids are changing, and I'll show you some stuff on millennium kids in a minute, which is very interesting. Our kids are changing, so we have to adapt to that. But we don't want robots in there. We want problem solvers. So, back up, Mark, back up. Once you get the ball from that side to Mark. Mark, and then you get it. Any way you like, just get it there, right? Yep, yep. Good. Okay, go. Go. Mark. Right, now. What's the light? What's the... Yeah, okay. So now, I haven't really given him any coaching, but I have.
Yeah, because that's what happens in a game.
Correct. What these two are doing now is discovering. They're problem solvers. Yeah? So we don't tell them how to find this detail of how to do something. As long as we can get the concept of passing and being good at, you know, dealing with the interruptions and all that sort of stuff, that what we call mess,
yep.
Then we're developing problem solvers and they'll work it out. Kids today are really inventive, they work things out. You see them out there, they're working out different shots. And how did we get to, you know, under basket dunks? They weren't in the game 20 years ago. Somebody's gone out and gone, well, that feels good. But now we've got tomahawks and we've got all sorts of dunks coming in the game. And we've got all these just ball handling. That wasn't in the game. As a traditional coach, he used to just sit there and say, okay, maybe through the legs, but that's too fancy, you know. No, you keep the ball here. You don't want the ball through the legs, you know. If you want to do it, cross it over like this, you know. Because that was regarded as showboating in the traditional sense. Make sense? Can you relate to that? Yeah. Okay, so now we let the kids explore. And Steph Curry and his ball handling drills, and you see little five-year-olds that can dribble the ball like there's no tomorrow, because they've discovered. They've been let discover. And that's conventional coaching. And with that comes motion offenses. So read and react, dribble drive. You've heard those terms before, okay? Flow. They're motion offences, which means they're a set of concepts that the kid is given, and then they get to explore and work out how they want to use it. Okay, make sense? So what we're doing is we're trying to shift now, because of the kids' changes, and because of this robotic basketball we're generating, into a much more fluent problem solver who has the freedom to be creative. And we reward that. And with that, you get a little bit of untidiness. Your training sessions, when you walk into that sort of training session, it's like bedlam. The messier, the better, you know. The messier, the better. Like, we'll play 5-on-5. And when I call your number, you're each given a number. When I call your number, you've got to hit the baseline. Right? So you're on defense. 5 on defense, 5 on offense. So I call 5, defense, got to hit the baseline. What that does is it's now 5-on-4 for a split second, so that's the game, isn't it? You know, suddenly one player gets caught. Okay. So it's all messy. Or we might go out and play 5-on-5 and say, Mark, you can only pass the ball. Yeah? Okay? So you can shoot the ball and dribble the ball. You can't dribble the ball. Okay? Myra, you're really good, so I'm going to let you shoot, dribble, and pass. Okay? Richard, you can only rebound and pass the ball. Okay? So now I'll give you those and you go, go, play. And over here I've got another team and I say, right, Lockie, I want you to be a dribbler, okay? So tell me, Julia, I want you to be a shooter-passer. Sharon, I want you to be a passer only. And what you have to do is work out what they are, and they've got to work out what you are, and suddenly that's the game of basketball as well. Is my player that I'm marking a shooter or not? So I'm a mark. I've just been four plays, and he hasn't shot the ball. Mustn't be a shooter. Good, okay. What do I do if he's not a shooter? Step off and help somebody else. Yeah? Okay. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So, Tom, what age is the best to start that problem-solving coaching at?
Six.
Because there's a...
Any age.
Because, you know, I suppose there's also a, you know, young kids, just that constant repetition and in skill practice as well.
I think you've got to use a bit of both,
yeah,
to be honest. Rather than pull up the whole flow of the training session like we used to and take a lot of time explaining things, we like to use what we call our coach's eye. And you know yourself, you see a kid and go, that didn't look right, you know, like he's struggling to get that ball in. Maybe if he steps out, he can get that pass in. So you see that, and then you coach on the run. You don't stop the whole drill. Hey, pull him out for a little bit and go, right, just step when you do it. Or, better still, you say, you seem to be having trouble getting that ball into the post. How do you think you can solve that? Because if he discovers it, he'll remember it better than you telling him. So you become more a facilitator. But you do both. But we don't do it in the formal setting. We do have repetition. We have a lot of repetition. But we have a lot more game play, small game groups.
So that would mean that they would be able to read the play better.
Correct.
As they get older.
Correct. I played that game with the under-16s rep team for Townsville yesterday with the you do this, you do this. They had no idea. I said, I rest my case. You know, they went for 5 minutes. They still didn't realise that this guy, Mark, wasn't going to pass, wasn't going to dribble the ball, he wasn't going to shoot the ball. He was, you know, he got the ball right underneath and they were playing defence on him and everything. Then they got off him and he's still not shooting the ball and they still playing defence like this on him. I said to the boys, did you pick up anybody different? Oh, yeah, my player just didn't want to shoot the ball. He said, so what were you doing about it? Oh, I stood prevented the coach. I was right up in his face. Oh, is that the game? Oh, not really, I suppose. Oh, well, what are we going to do next time? So then we played again. Suddenly now he's helped and I'll find somebody else. You know what I mean?
So it wouldn't hurt, it would be okay in a game situation to, when you call a timeout, to say to your team, tell me what your player, if you're doing this in defense.
Yeah. What are they doing? Are they shooting?
Yeah.
Have they shot the ball?
Yeah.
Are they dribbling right? Are they dribbling on the left? Are they dribbling? Some of them don't dribble. But to answer your question, I'd start it right at the beginning.
Yeah.
The repetition comes from the environment you create. So the athletes you get are a product of the environment you create.
Mm.
Okay. Too many times coaches say, oh, I've got shit ass players. No, sorry, you're a shit ass coach. Excuse the French. But realistically, have you heard of Bobby Knight? The guy threw the check. Okay. Loved his players with a passion. Very much a traditional coach. But one thing, he backed up his players. And if there was a problem, he'd say, I've got to go back to the training environment and try and work out how I create a better environment for it. His son, on the other hand, very similar, followed through Bobby's footsteps. We'd come out of the game and say, I've just got crap players. I need different players. No, you've got college level players, but you're not creating an environment for them to succeed. So if you think about every opportunity you get in front of the kids, the environment you create, you'll get the result with that sort of athlete. So if you've got a good athlete with a lot of attitude, you've created that in the environment. Now either they're bored, which is a big issue with kids. If they're bored, they'll mucker up. But if you play these little small games with them, absolutely practice. And maybe one time we'll come up and I'll run a session like that. Because in a traditional coaching session, they don't get time to stop. They're all in the game, so all four or five of them. So they're not all standing in line waiting for their turn. They're in the drill because the drill is now small game concept stuff specific. So if you think about it, you can get ball handling. Okay, you're going to use your left hand to dribble. You're going to shoot left hand. You know, you change your game rules. There's so many constraints that you can apply to a drill to get the result you want. Time is something. So I've seen a coach the other day. I want the ball pushed up the floor quicker. We want to be quick. You know, we want to get on the rim in 5 seconds. Well, count 5 seconds. 5, 4, 3, 2, didn't get to the rim. Turnover. Let's go, 5, 4. Guess what happens after about 10 minutes? They play fast. Yeah. So use time. Use space. 3-on-2, 2-on-1. Who runs those drills? Anybody run those drills where you're playing 2-on-1? You usually do it on a full court. How many times in a game do you get 2-on-1 full court? Maybe once. Maybe twice. How many times in a game do you get 2-on-1 but it's in a very small space? So why don't you play your 2-on-1 in the quarter court? So put a cone on the keyway, on the elbows. Everyone knows what the elbow is. Put a cone. You've got to go inside the elbow. Once you're inside the elbow, you can use the whole key, but it's 2-on-1. You've got to play the 2-on-1 in that space. Now what happens is all those imperfections in timing and space will become more apparent. When you've got a full court, and one player has to guard, you can have imperfections in timing and space and still get a layup, yes? Okay. But when you find space, things become more magnified. You go, ooh, that wasn't quite the right timing. That pass was half a second slow, and guess what? You got blocked. It's got to be right on the money. Think about those sort of things. Equipment. You know, change the equipment. Put chairs in the way. There's your screens. Use that screens. You teach screens. Does anybody here teach screens? Yeah? Good? Yeah? No?
Not yet.
Okay. I even teach screens at under 6. Under 8. I'll show you how. Okay? Hand up if you've ever played Tiggy. You know what Tiggy is? Tips? Go tag your friend, you and your mate. Okay, Timmy, come up here. Okay, I think I'll play tag. Okay, so have you ever played that game? With a pole and you run around the yard and get away from it. It's what we're doing.
It's still real.
What we're doing, so it's on. I'll give you a break. Sharon, pop up. You don't have to run very far. But as you move, so you move to come and get me nice and slow, because I'm old. I make the adjustment because what I'm now reading is not the screen, I'm reading the defense.
Yeah.
How many times when they curl around, follow you around on the screen, right, so you follow me around, does this person leave enough gap to let that person through? But if you play Tiggy, what you do is you, as they came around and they followed you, you curl cut, wouldn't you? Come on, we just talk the curl cut. Why did we turn curl cut? Because that's how we got away from the play. Does that make sense?
Mm.
Okay. And if that's too easy, use other equipment and say, right, there's two chairs. Come on, Sharon.
Oh, God, sorry.
But what am I doing? I'm adjusting on the defense.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So that's contemporary coaching.
And
when I say, you know, I mean, you're only limited by your imagination. If you think about all the constraints you can put into a game, if you want to speed things up, timer. You can countdown timer. What it also do in the countdown timer, it helps them get accustomed to that late shot clock stuff. You know, Andre Lamas has a great saying. And I speak of Andre because I spent a lot of time with Andre in the Australian program. I was the Australian women's coach, he was the Boomers coach, and we talked about the fact that we were national coaches, but we weren't coaching any games. So it's like we've got to go to a Paralympics or an Olympics with the major skill we need and no fine-tuning done on it. So I spent a lot of time with Andre. No disrespect to Aaron, I haven't spent any time with Aaron. But if Aaron was here, I'd love to have the conversation. But Andre talks about late shot clock is a great time to score. That's a different concept, isn't it? Because what happens normally in the late shot clock, you guys don't have shot clocks, but late in the game. Hey, it's warm!
Precious to watch.
Yeah, okay. So they look at it the absolutely opposite and say it's a great time to score. I'll share with you, not tonight, but Simon Sinek is the guy I'm going to show you who talks about the millennium child. Anybody seen his video on millennium kids? Okay, good. He's got some other stuff, but one he really talks about is nervousness. You know, have you ever had to go and do something and you, oh shit, how are you going? Oh, nervous. I'm really shitting it now. I've got to go up and do this. I've got to go and speak to this crowd. He's changed the mindset. But nervousness is an electrical impulse, right? That you get sweaty, you start to twitch, you lose focus and all that sort of stuff. If you had to describe excitement, what's the physiological description of excitement? Sweaty. So he said, it's the same. It's the same physiological state as nervousness. So what he does now is he turns it over and says, I'm excited. Different mindset. Because it's the same. The body's reacting the exact same way. And if you put that inside of the head, so the kids catch it, late shot clocks and late in games, it becomes exciting. And I often tell the story, one of my greatest achievements as a coach was not winning or losing or anything like that, because I don't coach for that. I do like winning, like most of us, but to me, win represents one thing and one thing only. What is important now? Win. What is important now? So you think about that. You're coaching under 13 team, under 12 team, you're in a championship game. How you present and create the environment in that last time out with 30 seconds to go and you're up by one or down by one, will set those kids up for a long time to come. Yeah? Because if they have a bad experience, the next time they get to that experience, what are they going to do? Yes. Tense up. And I tell this story because I think it's my proudest coaching moment. It turned out to be a positive experience anyway, but it wouldn't have mattered whether we won or lost. And as soon as he knows me, from Ashgrove days, and we used to get belted. We were a rugby school, we weren't a basketball school. And we used to play these teams and they beat us by 20 points. But to a T, by the time halfway through the season came through, we'd lose, but my kids were smiling. Like, great, that's great, we really had a good time. Do you remember those days? They weren't great athletes or anything, but they really knew that they performed the best they could. And they were happy with it. They just got beat by a better team. So again, I created that environment. The experience I'm talking about is under 23 World Championships, I was the head coach of the wheelchair team in Turkey when the gas explosions and all that happened in Syria. So we're 100 miles from the Syrian border where the explosions were happening. So it was a pretty tense environment, okay? And we're playing this World Championship and we're playing against couple of teams. We had three big games in that tournament, or four big games. We played Sweden first and they beat us by two, but we came out for it. We really played well. We played the Turks. We were up by 20 at half time. We thought we were going to get absolutely bashed and we'd be actually not able to get out of the stadium because they had 5,000. I don't know whether you've seen European Turkish players, but they fight in the stands and set off flares and all sorts of things. Yeah. So that was we were in this corner and we were winning. It probably wasn't 20, probably about 15, but you know, she was, how are we going to get out of here? We ended up losing the game. Probably a good thing, but didn't matter anyway. We beat Iran, who kicked our butts at the qualifiers by 15. And then we played this game against GB because we lost in the semi to Sweden again. We played GB in the bronze medal game. And we're about 30 seconds out and we're down by one. And I called timeout. Pretty tense, back and forth, great game. There's 5,000 people in the stand yelling for both teams. It's just awesome for kids under 23 and kids in chairs, basically, with disabilities, who are really good athletes. I mean, these are exceptional athletes. When you've got a kid that can handstand on his chair, he's a pretty good athlete. He plays in the Australian men's team now. Anyway, so I called the time out, and I sat down, and they all came around me. Right, guys, and they were ready for the big speech. I said to my coach, this is going to be a good experience. And I said, have a look. Look around. Yeah, you know, listen to that crowd. Yeah. What do we need to do, coach? I said, this is good. This is what it's all about. How good is this? Get out and have some fun. just go out and enjoy the last 30 seconds, because you're not going to ever be in this position again. Just enjoy it. You know, how good is this? So what I did is I turned it around to just to relax, and they all just went, oh, okay. We ended up winning it by one. But it could have gone either way. It wouldn't have mattered. It wouldn't have mattered to the kids, because both teams embraced at the end of the game, because they knew it was just such a hard battle. They had a coach similar to us. So, you know, it was just two teams going at it. And I thought that set those kids up for a lot more than just basketball. Because they've now been in a pressure situation, put it in perspective of what was important. Now, unfortunately, we had a reminder of that in the under-20s national boys team. I don't know whether you guys know, but they went to the nationals, and they lost the first couple of games, so everyone was a bit down. One of the players got a call when his girlfriend died in a car crash, so that really put the whole tournament in perspective for those kids, sadly. So remember that when you coach, you know, what is important now? All right? That's just the way I coach anyone. Because I like to think that you have the joy of coaching when a player comes up to you after 25 years and say, I brought my kids back because I really enjoy the game of basketball, I'm still playing. Yeah. Because chances are we're not going to coach too many NBA players. Are we? Let's be honest. Does that make sense? Does that help?
Yeah.
So I've got a bit off topic there because we get quite passionate about it. But traditional coaching. The challenge for you is, how do you create those environments? But if you think about it, think about the team concept or the concept you're trying to teach. So think about your team right now. Okay? I want you to self-reflect. Think about your team. I want you to try and tell me what they need to work on. What's the one thing, if you could have in your training session to work on and get it solved today, what would it be? Does that make sense? For your team, or one of your teams. Anybody want to go first? Julie, you want to go first?
I was coaching last year?
Yeah.
And this year I just some training, so I broke my arm last year.
Right.
Julie. Oh,
okay.
I stopped.
Okay.
For last year, my team is under 12 girls.
Yep.
It's the problem is the kids.
Have you had that conversation with the parents?
Mm,
not really.
You don't know that?
Yeah.
So I'm asking you to do something completely different. I'm asking you to address it front on.
Okay.
As long as they know what you're about early on, and you give them an opportunity to speak their mind there, you've done all you can at that stage. If they then rise up at the end of the season and say, my kid didn't go, we talked about this at the beginning of the season. Okay. Firstly, you don't discuss things in front of parents with the kids, in front of the kids, because that undermines you and them. Okay. Second thing is, the most important thing for a kid after training is the ride home. So if you don't have their support, the ride home could be undoing everything you did at training. Okay, that coach is silly, you know.
Yes.
Julia doesn't know what she's doing. You know, that sort of talk from the parents really undermines the whole concept of the team. So you need to get them on board, and they need to sign up to that. Okay, but if you ignore it, they won't know what you're about.
Okay, if now how you make decisions? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, us?
Yep.
7.
Yep.
If this 5 win on the game, we win more time, most of the time.
Yep.
These 2 are a little bit less of the time.
Yep.
You give the equal time or what you have to do?
It depends on what you believe. My philosophy is I try to give equal time, especially 12s and 14s. And
yeah.
What's important now, they all play. Mel Downer, who just came out of the Centre of Excellence, they played in the National Seagull competition. The AIS team, or the Centre of Excellence team, played in the Seagull competition. They had regulated number of minutes per player, so that every player got at least 15 to 18 minutes a game. All right? That's at the top level.
Yeah.
So you use that as an example. They're doing that at the top level, because what's important now for those kids? Not winning Seagull. Well, for them, it was more about practicing their skills. So how are you going to practice your skills if you're sitting on the bench? Having fun is another thing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So again, use those examples where if they can do it at the Centre of Excellence, then why can't we do it here? Because you have to convince them of what's important now. Okay. And if they say, oh, I'm more about my kid, well, your kid's not going to survive in basketball, because if he's an individual, most coaches won't pick him as they go up the ladder. So we need to then try and back that up. Okay. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So don't avoid it. Attack it front on. Yeah. And really, you can, if you get your parents on board, they can be the greatest source of positivity for you. Don't worry about it. Julia's okay. She's got this. She knows what she's doing. She's already spoken to me about all of this. And sometimes you have to touch base with them a couple of times just to say, hey, can you have a chat to George on the way home? He seemed pretty down today. Pump him up. I thought he did a pretty good job. So then mum and dad says, that was a good effort, George. I thought, you know, didn't quite work for you, didn't get the baskets we needed, but I thought you really played well.
But they don't.
Yep. They don't do it.
Mm.
Could be a logical reason why they don't do it. So,
one of the things we are doing now with Basketball Queensland is we've linked in these guys. So, anybody seen DISC before?
Yeah.
Oh, you've used it?
Yeah.
Yes. So DISC is a behavioural assessment. Okay. And what it does is the guy who invented it way back in 1921, he didn't claim it, so a lot of people involved it. It doesn't talk about personality. It's not a personality test. It is a behavioural test. Okay. And it talks about the different types of behaviours. And in ours, let's go back here. He came up with this model here that talks about 4 quadrants of behaviour. Okay, so on one axis you've got guarded versus open. So some people are guarded, some people are open. Yeah. Other people are task or goal focused. Some people are relationship people focused in their behaviour. On this axis, he talked about decision making being fast or slow. So you know, some people just, yeah, okay, I've got a coach, don't need to tell me anymore, I'm fast, right? Okay. Whereas others, what do you mean? You know, let me take that on board for a little bit. There's also people on this axis tend to be out this way more direct, and in this axis more indirect. Okay.
So you end up with these four quadrants of types of behaviours. You've got a dominant behaviour. Now let me describe it. It's a direct, task-focused, goal-focused. Now that's the sort of guy that will get up, give him the ball, make it happen. Paddy Mills. Okay. Who else is in that? Nathan Duarte is sort of in that role. I'm just trying to relate it to people. And Susie Bakovic. Eric, just give me the ball, let me do it, I'll go and do it for you, coach. Okay? About 10% of the population are in that sort of role. Now, if you told them, I need you to do this, then, yeah. In fact, you don't even have to tell them what I need you to do, you don't have to tell them what the goal is. Put the ball in the hole. Okay? They're the ones at the end of the game, they want the ball. Yeah? Trouble is, you can't have a whole team of those. Because you have a whole team of those, suddenly, there's only one basketball and five people. They don't share it, they don't pass it, they block one person, and suddenly it all starts to go wrong. On this side, you've got your extroverts and your talkative people. So they're the sort of people that if your team's running along and it seems to be getting a bit flat, you look down the bench and say, oh, he's a real animal, he is, or she's a real energy bubble, you know, bubbles. Let's get her out there. And suddenly things lift. So that's what the I personality or the influence personality is in the extroverted type, person-oriented, okay? Over here, you've got the slow and steady. People focused, but really slow and steady. They're the supportive people. Stop doing that to me. They're the supportive people. So they're the ones that set the screens. They're the team people. That, you know, yeah, coach, whatever you need, you know. But they are reluctant to shine out. So they would be less likely to take that shot. Okay? They're the ones that say, what do you need me to do, coach? I'll get out of set some blocks. Oh, you want me to be the person that scores the basket at the end of the game? For them, that's a real challenge because they haven't digested all of that. Okay? They're a role player. Okay? And then you've got your game plan people, your conscientious people, the ones that are really analytical, and they like structure. And they like structure. They're still task-oriented, but they're a bit slower than the Ds as far as doing that. So 10% of the population there, 40, 30, 20, something around those sort of numbers. Now, your team is probably made up of those sort of people. But if you went to this person here and said, you got to be the scorer, he'd cheat. Or she'd cheat. Oh, because they need time to digest that. Now, if you gave it to them 3 weeks out and said, we want to set up a play, we worked on a play, they can see that the play will work, you'll get them to do it. But if you give it to them in an instant, like I did, who's got questions? Anyone goes, woo. Okay. Make sense?
Yeah.
So knowing this, that's the stuff, and we've got a heap of information on this as well. We've just partnered with Athlete Assessments, so they do all the soft skills of understanding your team and their behaviours. Okay, you've probably seen it with your teaching, you've seen it with yours. Did you do the disc?
I did it through a mentor session. Yep. Yeah, I was very...
And you find it?
Yeah, really made sense when I Excellent. Went through the whole process. Yeah.
Now we do it with coaches, and you can do it as well. Unfortunately, we don't. We have to pay for it. So you know, to do your disc is about $60, but you get full access to everything. And it's an online survey. You can buy it through our coaches app, and it gives you a 48-page report. Okay. Where it becomes important, it talks about these sort of personalities, and you knowing that. It really comes down to here. This is the behaviour stuff. So if you have a natural style. Everybody has a natural style and an adapted style. So when you're sitting at home with mum and dad and the kids or, you know, hubby and that sort of stuff, you tend to be under no stress, so you tend to adapt your natural style. Okay. All right. That's the way you are. When you're under pressure, you tend to go back to your natural style. Your natural behaviours come back. So if you're an extrovert and you're in the game, in the situation, you calm yourself down, because I'm a high I. So I calm myself down in the game coaching to try and keep things calm. So I adopt a lot of S and C to try and get people to stay focused on the process, because you don't want to hype up too much, yeah. But I'm an extrovert, okay? So I adapt my extroversion down when I coach. Make sense? Okay. So depending on the situation, you'll adjust your behaviours to adapt it into a certain way. Okay? And players will do that too. Players will do that too. Now, some of your players don't adapt very well. Part of our role is coaching is to understand their behavioural styles and how to get them to adapt, because you need your Ds to put away the need to want to score or be the scorer sometimes to play the team game. Make sense? All right. So the situation times the behaviour will equal the result. You evaluate and say, how did that look? Maybe I need to up my D a little bit to get this D under control. Because the best way to get a dominant personality under control is not to go, oh, great job. Because they're not interested in that. They're interested in focus. You've got a reason. You've got to convince them. I'm committed to this. You know, if you share the ball, we'll win. Because that's all they worry about. We'll win. Okay? Got me? So that's what this sort of teaches you. And I'll get to something here in a second so you can see what I mean. And the disc goes through all of this. It talks about what's their greatest motivations, what's their strengths, what their limitations are, and what their biggest fears are. So once you know what your kids are, you can quickly assess, and then from there, I'm trying to get to something here. Hopefully it's here. There it is there. You can look at, okay, if I've got an S style, what should I do? When they dislike conflict, right? An S will sheer away from it. They're indirect. They don't like open. You know, they're open, but they're indirect. So act non-aggressively. Focus on, you know, the common interest and the need for support. Whereas with a D, they love conflict. Tendency towards conflict. What do you mean, coach? I know what I'm doing. Get out of my face. Yeah? That sort of play. Nothing wrong with that. There's no right or wrong. People are different. So with them, you have to argue with conviction. You have to convince them. So you go up, as I said, pat them on the back. And there's a little card game you can get. So we get coaches to do the full profile so they understand their natural style and their ways to adapt and educate them how to communicate. We have a little card game that they play. Discard game. So it's got little, it's basically got words on it, and it's got a dot on it, different coloured dots. Can you see that? Cards. But it's a handful of cards, basically. It's got words. And what you do is you pass it around your team, and you say, pick out the cards that best represent you. Okay? Make sense? And what that does for us is that will tell you what their natural style is if you don't know how to determine it. But when you do the disc, it helps you better understand those styles. Okay. So we always look at, as coaches, and Andre is very good at this, we always focus on X's and O's, or drills. Okay. That's what we think of coaches. And that's how Andre started. He'll openly admit that he spent a lot of time on X's and O's, understanding offences and defences and how to run drills and that sort of stuff. He spent a little bit of time on game concepts and very little time on player relationships. Now, I can honestly say, he's right the opposite way. He's 80% player relationships because, again, if you can get them to work together, if they understand their relationships as well, then you're on a winner. Because now we're working as a team. Because you don't have in the team, oh, he's an idiot. He's not an idiot, he's just different to you, or she's different to you. And then he can understand what that is, or she can understand what that is. Oh, okay. But how do we work best together to get the result? Because the D's need the S's to set the screens. Yeah? We need the C's to follow the game plan so we don't get off the page. We need the I's to bring us energy. So we need everybody in that mix. That makes sense? So, yeah, so we're working with them, and there's a little thing in here around the group model, which is goals. So we've done that with teams. Anybody's done that with teams? You set goals. If goals on its own won't get it done. You've got to understand what the roles are, so you don't have to understand what their particular behaviour type is. Because the more you're towards their natural behaviour type, the less they have to adapt. The easier it is for it. If you have to adapt to a situation like you're going to a new workplace and you have to adapt, and you tend to, no, I'm an extrovert, but I go into a new workplace and I have to be quiet. That takes energy. Okay, so if you can get them to understand their roles and stay in their natural style, then get them to understand each other's style with interpersonal relationships. And then the last part is process. Put that in play while you're teaching them skills and drills, then apply the relationship side of things. That makes sense? So there's a lot more to it than just getting out there doing bits and pieces. Now, I'm talking, you know, a lot of information, but it doesn't have to be arduous. You can just, you just do a little bit of this reading and suddenly you'll be able to pick them. That's better.
So is that something you could, what's been us development of them working out what each other is as well as probably?
It is, well, yeah, they're probably, we don't do DISC on anything lower than an under 18.
Okay.
At a state level. We wouldn't even do it at a rep level.
Okay.
Under 18, they've got the maturity to sort of start to work out.
Yeah.
Anything other than that, we, as coaches, work out what they are.
Yeah.
And then we plot them on the graph. And then we start to, because we understand that,
yeah,
we start to put them in scenarios and having conversations in drills. And you create the drills now,
yeah,
where the D has to be the screen.
Yeah.
So he understands what the S has to go through.
Yeah.
Or something along those lines. So it changes the way you sort of start to approach. And even in a game scenario,